welcome you all. In today's lecture, we'll discuss about hydrodynamic journal bearings. We all know hydrodynamic journal bearings have advantages over rolling contact bearings, and hence, therefore, they are very popular in IC engines, turbo generators, marine propeller shaft, and many more applications. In this lecture, we'll discuss about the principle of operation of hydrodynamic bearings, then mechanism of pressure development, then Petrov's equation to study the friction in hydrodynamic lubrication, and then different regions in hydrodynamic lubrication.
Contents of this lecture are introduction about hydrodynamic bearings, principle of working of hydrodynamic lubrication, mechanism of pressure development in hydrodynamic lubrication, Petrov's equation for hydrodynamic journal bearing, nomenclature of hydrodynamic journal bearings, and regimes of hydrodynamic lubrication. Now we know hydrodynamic lubrication is used in crankshaft bearings, large turbo generators, centrifugal pumps, hydraulic turbines, and machine tool guideways due to its advantages over rolling contact bearings.
Hydrodynamic lubrication operates on hydro, that means water, here oil is considered, and dynamic, that means in motion. So the pressure developed in dynamic motion. So these bearings are known as hydrodynamic bearings. In hydrodynamic bearings, thick film is generated when the speed is at rated speed, hence these bearings are also known as thick film or full film lubrications. Hydrodynamic journal bearings, since there is a sliding between the layers of the lubrication as well as sliding between the upper layer and the bearing as well as lower layer and the shaft, these bearings are also known as sliding contact bearings.
Let us discuss the principle of working of hydrodynamic lubrication. In hydrodynamic lubrication, the load supporting high pressure fluid film is created due to the wedge action and relative motion between the two surfaces. The fluid or oil adhered to the moving surface is pulled into a wedge shaped zone at a sufficiently higher velocity to create a thick and high pressure lubricant film, which is necessary to separate the two surfaces. In this picture, we can clearly see this is a bearing which is stationary and this is a shaft which is rotating, and this yellow portion is nothing but a lubricating film which is separating these two parts.
Now let us see the principle of operation of hydrodynamic journal bearing. Initially, when the shaft is at rest, since there is no motion, there is directly metal to metal contact as the separating film is not developed, and therefore the shaft touches the bearing as shown in figure at point A. Now as the journal starts rotating and initially there is point to point contact, metal to metal contact, the frictional force is dominating and therefore it pushes the shaft in the opposite direction to the direction of motion as shown in figure at point B. This point is known as the seat of pressure. As the shaft speed further increases, the oil is pulled into the wedge shaped region and therefore the fluid film starts developing, causing the separation of the two relative parts in motion. And as the fluid film gets developed, the frictional force gets minimized and therefore the shaft is pushed in the direction of the rotation. The region CD is the converging region which supports the external load coming due to the pressure force, positive pressure force developed.
Advantages of hydrodynamic bearings. They are simple in construction and easy to maintain. They have low initial as well as maintenance cost. They do not require any auxiliary equipments like pumps. They are reliable. They have low power loss when running at full speed. Now let us see limitations of hydrodynamic bearings. They cannot be used at low speed applications as well as very high speed applications. At low speeds, we have seen that there is a metal to metal contact takes place and high amount of friction. Hence, at low speeds, they cannot be used. They have high frictional power loss at low speeds due to high starting friction. Just now we talked about it. They have very poor positional accuracy, and these are not suitable for the frequent starting and stopping applications due to the initial metal to metal contact. Applications of hydrodynamic bearings. Gas turbines, electrical generators, propeller shafts, hydro turbines, IC engines, turbo generators, and hard disk drives. Now let us discuss about mechanism of pressure development in hydrodynamic lubrication. For this, we will be considering two experiments. One is two parallel plates separated by a fluid flow, and second is two non-parallel plates separated by fluid flow. So let us discuss one by one. So first consider two parallel surfaces separated by a fluid film. Now consider two parallel and flat surfaces separated by a viscous fluid film of constant film thickness H, which is shown in the figure on the next slide. The width of the plates, which is perpendicular to the plane of the slide, is very large, and hence the side leakage is neglected, and therefore the flow becomes one dimensional flow. The upper plate is moving with velocity capital U parallel to the lower plate, which is stationary. Now considering no slip condition, that means the laminar flow, the velocity of the fluid linearly varies from 0 at the lower plate, since it is stationary, to the U at the upper plate. So this is the velocity distribution at the inlet P dash P, and this is the velocity distribution at outlet or exit Q dash Q. Now as we can see, the velocity distribution at sections PP dash, that is at entrance, and QQ dash, that is exit, is identical to the volume flow rate which we calculate Q is equal to area into velocity at these two sections will be equal. And therefore the flow at these two sections results only due to velocity gradient. As we can see, the area is constant, so the flow is because of the velocity gradient. Since the velocity gradients are equal at these two sections, the flow continuity is satisfied without any pressure built up within the fluid film. Thus, the slider bearing with parallel surfaces cannot support any load. If the load is applied on the upper plate, the fluid will be squeezed out and the upper plate will rest over the lower plate once the fluid is squeezed out completely. This is the principle of operation of squeeze film lubrication, which we will see later on. Now let us discuss the second experiment, two non-parallel surfaces separated by fluid film. So let us consider again two non-parallel and convergent flat surfaces separated by a viscous fluid film as shown in below figure. So we can see here, this is the plate. The upper plate is parallel to the x-axis, whereas the stationary plate is inclined at a particular angle. So these two surfaces form a convergent film at two sections. Now, as usual, the upper plate is moving with velocity capital U, while the lower inclined surface is stationary. The volume flow rate at any section is proportional to the area of the velocity distribution diagram. As we have seen, Q is equal to A into V. Therefore, the volume flow rate at any section is calculated equal to area of velocity distribution diagram at that particular section. If the velocity distribution at sections PP dash and QQ dash are linear as is shown by dotted lines, the volume flow rate of fluid flowing through section PP dash is greater than the volume flow rate flowing through section QQ dash. And therefore, since the flow is differing, the flow continuity is not satisfied. And therefore, there will be a pressure buildup in the fluid film until the flow continuity is satisfied. So here you can see these dotted lines show the identical velocity distribution, whereas this dark line shows the actual velocity distribution at particular section. Now the pressure will be maximum at some section EE dash where pressure gradient is zero. So here where this speed P maximum is shown, here as we can see the slope of the pressure distribution curve, here del P by del X is zero. So here the pressure will be maximum. In the three dimensional diagram, here we can clearly see the pressure is varying from inlet. It is maximum at somewhere where the slope of this pressure gradient is, or pressure gradient is zero, or the slope of this pressure curve is zero, here the pressure is maximum and again it starts decreasing to the exit. So the pressure induced flow opposes the velocity induced flow at PP dash, that is at entrance. Now we can see clearly initially the pressure is developed because of the self-rotation of the shaft. So the flow is driven because of the self-rotation, that is velocity driven, and therefore the pressure induced flow opposes the velocity induced flow at entrance. But at the exit we can see the positive pressure is developed, again the shaft is also rotating, therefore at the exit the pressure induced flow assists the velocity induced flow. Now to satisfy the flow continuity, the velocity distribution at entrance PP dash and at the exit QQ dash is shown by the solid lines. So we can see, we have seen in the last slide diagram, the solid lines which we have shown, those indicate the actual velocity distribution. As the flow at these two sections is same, the area of the velocity distribution diagram are same. Thus, two convergent and flat surfaces separated by viscous fluid film can generate a positive pressure and supports an external load. Now let us see Petrov's equation for hydrodynamic journal bearing. The phenomenon of hydrodynamic journal bearing friction was first explained by Petrov in 1883. Now he made some assumptions that the journal, or it is also called a shaft, is concentric to the bearing and there is no eccentricity between the bearing and the journal. This assumption is fairly accurate only if the load is light, the speed of rotation is high, the projected area of the bearing is large and the viscosity of the lubricant is high enough. So consider a shaft rotating in a bearing as shown in below figure. The annular space between the shaft and journal, shaft and bearing, which is shown by the yellow color, is occupied or filled with the help of lubricating oil. Now let us consider capital W, radial load acting on the journal or shaft in newtons. NS is a journal or shaft speed in RPS. Small r is journal radius in mm. Capital R is a bearing radius in mm. Capital L bearing length in mm. C is a radial clearance, which is calculated as the bearing radius minus shaft radius, that is capital R minus small r in mm. Mu is absolute viscosity of the lubricating oil in Pascal seconds. Capital U, surface velocity of the journal in millimeters per second, which is given as 2 pi r into ns. Small p, bearing pressure or load per unit projected area in newtons per millimeter square. So let us now see, this is the projected area of the journal. 2r is the length and 2r is the width and l is the length of the bearing. So this is the projected area of the bearing and this w is acting on this area. So p will be what? It will, pressure will be load upon area. So w upon 2r into l. So therefore p is calculated as w upon 2rl. Capital A, surface area of the journal in millimeter square, that is equal to 2 pi r into l, and f is coefficient of friction. Now according to Newton's law of viscosity, the tangential frictional force acting on the journal due to viscous drag is calculated as f is equal to mu into a into du by dy. So du is the velocity gradient. So here velocity is constant, so that is u, and dy is nothing but the distance between the two surfaces in y direction, that is nothing but the radial clearance. So c. So therefore this frictional force will be equal to mu into a into u upon c. So substituting values of a and surface velocity u, we have f is equal to mu into 2 pi r l, which is nothing but the surface area, into 2 pi r into n s, which is nothing but the velocity, surface velocity of the shaft, divided by capital C. Now the frictional torque acting on the journal due to the drag is, torque is equal to force into radius. So with the help of this we can calculate this frictional torque. So Tf is equal to F into R, substituting value of F from the above equation, and again the radius we have mu into 2 pi R L into 2 pi R N S upon C into R. So simplifying we get the frictional torque equal to 4 pi square R cube into mu into L into N S upon capital C. So let us consider this as equation 1. Now the equivalent coefficient of friction F, which will account for the frictional loss, is calculated by the equation Tf is equal to F, which is nothing but the coefficient of friction, into load W into radius of the shaft, that is R. So substituting value of F from that unit bearing pressure equation, we have Tf equal to F into P into 2RL into the radius of the shaft. Simplifying we get 2F PL R square. So let us consider this as equation 2. Now equating equations 1 and 2, we get 2F PL R square, that is equation 2, equal to 4 pi square R cube mu L into NS upon C. So simplifying and rearranging, we get the coefficient of friction F is equal to 2 pi square into mu into ns by p into r by c. So this equation is known as Petrov's equation, which contains two dimensionless parameters. One is mu into ns by p and second is r by c. Please remember, this equation is applicable only when the journal is concentric to the bearing. And this is possible only when the load is light and speed is higher. Now when load increases on the shaft, the journal becomes progressively eccentric and therefore the friction gradually increases, and therefore the frictional torque starts deviating from Petrov's analysis. But the Petrov's equation gives fair estimation of coefficient of friction mu for coefficient of friction F for the values of eccentricity ratio ranging from 0 to 0.5. Petrov's equation is not widely used nowadays due to availability of the data for the journal bearing for various eccentricity ratios. Now let us see nomenclature for hydrodynamic journal bearing. The nomenclature for journal bearing, hydrodynamic journal bearing, is shown in below figure. So let us consider this schematic of hydrodynamic journal bearing. Here left hand side we can see this is as a shaft and this is a bearing, and the oil is supplied through this hole and it gets accumulated between the annular space between shaft and bearing. So here we can see this yellow region indicates the annular space between the shaft and bearing. Now let capital R be the radius of the bearing in mm and small r with the radius of the journal or shaft in mm. Now let us see the first definition, radial clearance, which is denoted by capital C. So it is the difference in radii of the bearing and the journal, and it is calculated as capital R minus small r. Second definition, eccentricity, it is the distance between centers of the bearing and journal in operating condition. Please remember this E is the distance between the centers of bearing and the shaft. It is measured along the line joining these two centers. Minimum film thickness H0. It is the oil film thickness along the line joining the centers of the journal and the bearing. Eccentricity ratio. It is the ratio of eccentricity to the radial clearance. It is denoted by epsilon and calculated as the eccentricity E upon radial clearance capital C. Minimum oil film thickness ratio H0/C. It is the ratio of minimum oil film thickness to the radial clearance. Now let us see how to find out this. So here from this diagram you can see this capital R is nothing but the journal radius. So journal radius we can calculate, this is the journal radius. So this journal radius can be calculated as E, which is nothing but the eccentricity, plus this R, which is nothing but the shaft radius, plus H0. So therefore capital R is equal to E plus small r plus H0. So rearranging we can have capital R minus small r is equal to E plus H0, and we know that capital R minus small r is nothing but a radial clearance. So capital C equal to E plus H0. Now dividing this equation by C on both sides, we have E by C plus H0/C is equal to 1. Therefore E by C, H0/C we can have 1 minus E by C. Now E by C is nothing but the eccentricity ratio. We can have H0/C is equal to 1 minus epsilon, that is eccentricity ratio.
We have discussed different regimes of the lubrication. Let us consider the graph of coefficient of friction versus the bearing number mu into ns by p as shown in the figure. It is seen from the figure that this curve is divided basically into three main parts. First part is boundary lubrication, second part is mixed lubrication, and third part is hydrodynamic lubrication. In boundary lubrication, there is not complete separation of the surfaces. There is metal to metal contact takes place. At some places we have little bit separation of the two parts, but still more part is in contact, hence it is called as boundary lubrication. In mixed type of lubrication, the separation is more, but still at some places there is a separation and at some places there is a contact between the two surfaces, hence it is known as mixed lubrication. Whereas in case of hydrodynamic lubrication, we have complete redevelopment of the fluid film, which separates the two parts completely. In the start of hydrodynamic lubrication, there is a one region known as elastohydrodynamic lubrication, where there is a deformation of the components takes place, and therefore this region is known as elasto-hydrodynamic lubrication. Now let us discuss these regimes one by one in detail.
Now let us see the first region, boundary lubrication or thin film lubrication, indicated by part AB. When the bearing parameter mu ns by p is smaller, the fluid film thickness is smaller than the combined heights of the asperities which form on the contacting surfaces. Therefore, interlocking of the asperities take place and there is metal to metal contact. The cross size is easier is prevented by the coating of lubricant on the contacting surfaces. This is called as boundary lubrication or thin film lubrication. In boundary lubrication region, the coefficient of friction depends upon oiliness of the lubricant, surface finish of the contacting surfaces and materials of the contacting surfaces. In boundary lubrication, the coefficient of friction is independent on the viscosity of the lubricant. In this region, the coefficient of friction ranges from 0.08 to 0.15. The heavy load, low viscosity of the lubricant and insufficient supply of the lubricant lead to boundary lubrication. Every hydrodynamic bearing passes through the boundary lubrication at the beginning as well as at the end of the operation. As we have seen in case of operation principle when we studied, there we saw that as there is no sufficient lubricating film developed, there is a metal to metal contact and therefore due to high coefficient of friction, we have initial friction more. But this is the condition of boundary lubrication in case of hydrodynamic bearings. Now second, mixed lubrication indicated by part BC. In this region, the separation between the contacting surfaces is greater, but complete high pressure film separating the two surfaces is not formed. There are localized areas or patches of the fluid film, but these do not cover the entire surface. This kind of lubrication is known as mixed lubrication, where there is a little surface where lubricant reaches and separation occurs, but there are some regions where there is no lubricant and therefore direct metal to metal contact takes place. The mixed lubrication occurs when there is a partial breakdown of the thick film, fluid film. In this region, the value of coefficient of friction ranges from 0.02 to 0.08. Third type of region, hydrodynamic lubrication or thick film lubrication, shown by the region CE. When the bearing parameter mu ns by p is large enough, the two surfaces are completely separated by high pressure fluid film. The fluid film thickness is larger than the combined heights of the asperities on the contacting surfaces. Therefore, there is absolutely no metal to metal contact. This kind of lubrication or this kind of region is known as hydrodynamic lubrication or thick film lubrication. In this region, the coefficient of friction depends upon the viscosity of the lubricant. The value of coefficient of friction may be as low as 0.001. The coefficient of friction is independent on the surface finish as well as materials of the two surfaces, as there is no contact at all between the two surfaces. Therefore, surface finish as well as materials do not decide the value of coefficient of friction. In this region, there are circumstances where there is a deformation of the contacting surfaces due to high contact pressure. This region is known as elasto-hydrodynamic lubrication. It is shown by portion CD.
Now I will summarize this presentation. In this presentation, we discussed about basic principle of operation of hydrodynamic lubrication. We have seen advantages and limitations of hydrodynamic lubrication. We have seen some of the applications where these hydrodynamic journal bearings are used. Then we have seen the mechanism of pressure development in hydrodynamic lubrication by considering the two experiments, that is parallel plates experiment and non-parallel plates experiments. Then we discussed about a Petrov's equation to study the friction in hydrodynamic journal bearings. Then we have seen some important nominal lecture for hydrodynamic journal bearing. And then finally we discussed about different regimes in hydrodynamic lubrication. Thank you for your attention.